Greetings, and thank you for joining this revision of our civil rights training. I'm going to read to you a few things directly from the PowerPoint, but hopefully you can also see it in case you want to jot down some notes from that type of thing. This is going to be designed to be a generic enough training that'll fit several departments, including our Kids Cafe and our agencies alike. I will cite some specific examples as we go that may pertain particularly to agencies or Kids Cafe, but I'll make sure that you know which ones those are. As you can see, this is taken from the FNS Instructions 113-1, which is designed for this type of training. So, this I will read to you. The purpose of this civil rights instruction is to establish and convey policy and provide guidance and direction to the United States Department of Agriculture, known as USDA, Food and Nutrition Service, FNS, and its recipients and customers, and ensure compliance with and enforcement of prohibition against discrimination in TFAP and all FNS nutrition programs and activities, whether federally funded in whole or not. Now, if you forget anything else that I talk about today, I like to call this the Big Four. Each one of these subpoints has a lot of information that should guide you in what should be common sense civil rights understanding. So the Big Four. Number one, people have to know what's available. Number two, people need equal access to what's available. Number three, people need to be able to say no to what's available. And staff and volunteers need to know the first three. All right, so briefly, people need to know what's available. Specifically in our Kids Cafe program, there has to be some sort of press release talking about days and times and locations. Similarly, with our agencies, even though you do not have to do a formal press release, you do have to have some clearly defined parameters for your clients to know what days you're open, what hours you are open, and what's the criterion for how often they can come. So people have to know what's available. They need to have equal access, meaning you cannot let certain clients have more product or less product than other clients based solely on your discretion. It has to have some kind of legitimate reason, like number of people in their household or specific needs, but everybody has to have equal access to what you're offering. People need to be able to say no to what's available. That's very important, particularly for our agencies. We have a lot of different agencies. You may be religious in nature, you may be community action in nature. Whomever is receiving product from you needs to be able to receive that product with the ability to say no to other services that you offer. For example, some of our religious agencies may offer prayer, they may offer a service, they may offer attendance to something. That should not be contingent upon them receiving food. If they say, no thank you, I don't want the track, no thank you, I do not want to receive prayer, no thank you, I don't want to come to your Bible study, they should still be able to receive access to your food. So they have to be able to say no. Another thing to consider, especially for religious activities, is a lot of people like to advertise their bulletins, service times, tracks, those type of things. That's perfectly fine to offer to them, but they have to be able to have the ability to refuse it. In other words, you can't hide it in the grocery bag that they're taking in the hopes that they'll see it. You offer it on a table or say, hey, would you like to know more information about this? If they say no thank you, then they say no thank you. Kids Cafe, kids have the right to be able to say, no, I don't want to eat that. Well, you can't force them to eat. You can't say, well, you're going to sit here and you can't do this activity until you finish your snack. You cannot say you have to eat everything on your plate before you can get up and go outside to the playground. They have to be able to say no. Now that gets into another issue, is if they don't eat, you cannot also claim that they ate that day. They have to be able to say no. And then finally, whoever works for you, that's the big three, top three that they need to all understand in going into civil rights training for your staff and your volunteers. All right, protected classes. Remember, the main purpose for the civil rights training is to protect and enforce against any type of discrimination in these programs. So you need to know which classes are protected under this training. Program benefits and participation are made available without regard to race, national color, national origin, age, disability, sex, gender identity, religion, reprisal, political beliefs, marital status, familial or parental status, sexual orientation, or public assistance. Now, the big ones that have been around for ages are still the top ones, like the race, sex, national origin, color, all of those disabilities. Some of these are new to some of you, and that's because they're called a derivative or a progression of those. So in other words, when we talk about the protection against sex, it used to just talk about male and female, real simple. Well, now in recent times, gender identity has also come into play. That's now a derivative of that protective class. So if you have someone who comes in who identifies with a gender that maybe they don't look biologically to be, that's still a protected class. You cannot refuse service to them based solely upon that. Now that is especially important with our religious agencies. They may not fit a particular lifestyle or identity that you agree with in your tenets and your teachings and those kind of things. In your food program, you cannot discriminate against them because of that. Now, in your religious membership, then whatever you have laid out can be your criterion for membership, but not when it comes to the food distribution side. So pay real close attention to these and think through it. Now, I would like to point out to say that an angry bully is not a protected class. So sometimes in some of our food distribution programs, you'll have an individual who causes a ruckus, who says, "I'm not being treated fairly, I want this, I want that." You do have a right to ask them to step out of line and come back another time if they will not stop being unruly, because they are also infringing upon the civil rights of all your other well-behaved clientele and children in your kids' cafe service by acting that way. So don't be afraid to say, "I'm sorry, I can refuse service today unless you calm down." You can do that. If they do happen to complain about discrimination, and we'll cover this in just a second, you do not have to get into a lengthy debate with them. Every one of these programs, agencies and Kids Cafe alike, should have that Injustice for All poster. On that poster are specific instructions, emails, phone numbers of who they can call to report a potential discrimination. Allow them to have access to that poster, tell them that that's who keep you in line, and then encourage them to call the number if they like to file a formal complaint. Your next call should be to me or to our Kids Cafe staff and director so that they know that that might be coming down the pipe, and give us your incident report or write us up something so that we can have that on file. That would be much appreciative. All right, here's that public notification that I talked about. People need to know what's available. These TFAP state and local agencies and their recipients must have that public notification system. They have to know what's available, where the location, dates and times are, what the program's responsibilities, what they're offering you, and what they're responsible to ask for, the policy of non-discrimination, and the policy for filing a complaint. All that has to be in place. Luckily, for the generic side of it, that poster, a civil rights poster, covers most of that. The only thing you need to have in addition to is some sort of statement of hours, operation times, dates, what they need to bring with them in order to be a part of the program. That's the only additional thing that you would need to have. There's the poster. Right now, the one that works for both Kids Cafe and for our agencies is this green one. They do update this from time to time, and we'll make you aware annually as that comes out. But this needs to be prominently displayed. Some of our agencies and even Kids Cafe programs that are mobile, they don't have a pantry per se that they come to, but you bring things to them. This is still required to be prominently displayed. One thing, for example, that our Kids Cafe vans do is they have it taped to the outside door. So when they open the doors up to serve, there's the poster. Our agencies that do mobile pantries or mobile distributions, like in a park or a neighborhood, I recommend taking this poster, put it on a foam core or a sturdier piece of poster board, set it outside while you're doing it, pack it back up when you're done. If you're in a facility that you only occasionally use space for or has multiple uses, that poster works fine on the poster board as well. Display it while you're in operation. When classes or whatever other activities the church or facility has going on, you can pack it back up into a closet or take it with you and bring it back. But that has to be prominently displayed. If you do not have one, please contact us here and we will get you one. The non-discrimination statement. This is a rather long statement. This is the full statement that should be incorporated. It's also on the poster. If any printed materials, marketing materials that you put out, if there's enough space on that material, the full statement has to be put in there. If there's not enough space, then you simply say, this organization is an equal opportunity provider, that one little bit. But let me read the full statement. The non-discrimination statement must be included on all information, materials, and sources, including website, forms, public releases, announcement of scheduled distribution, and all other public announcements. This is the full statement. I'm not going to read all of that at all, but this is the full statement. Now, if the material is too small to include the full statement, the minimum that you have to include, this institution is an equal opportunity provider. That's the minimum that you have to have on there. So make sure that if you're going to, even if you advertise in your church bulletins about your food pantry and food giveaways and distribution, right underneath that announcement, you have to have at the minimum, this institution is an equal opportunity provider. Now, language assistance. This is also something you have to bear in mind, because if you're in this our service area in South Georgia, there are a lot of languages that are now prominent where we are. So state agencies, local agencies, and other sub-recipients are required to provide access to TFAP services to limited English proficiency persons and participants. You have to take reasonable steps to assure access is provided. So you do not have to have a formal position that's an interpreter as part of your program. However, you have to be able to show that you've taken reasonable steps to accommodate it. Now, most of the time, when someone of another language comes to these type of programs, they are either bilingual, they already speak some English, or there's someone with them, like a child or a grandchild or nephew, that serves as an interpreter because they've become used to needing that type of situation. If that is not the case, I recommend looking through your staff, your volunteers, even some of your clientele who are willing to be available in the case that you need language assistance. For example, can I have your cell phone so that I can call if someone comes in and I need an interpreter? And then you have them on record as, this is my language assistance person, this is how I contact them. Something in your filing, you know, paperwork that shows I do have somebody that does that. Persons with disabilities. Listen, when the Americans with Disabilities Act came into full effect, every physical structure in the country was required to change and accommodate or shut down. In other words, I used to be an aquatics director and run some pools. We had to look at how we could make every single pool accessible to anybody, whether it was lift chairs, whether it was ramps, whether it was zero entry for that. We had to look at doing it, or that section was going to be closed down. So you have to make sure that you are doing reasonable accommodations. In other words, if you do not have a ramp to this particular section, then there has to be someone who is a runner or a carrier who is willing to carry and meet things outside, carry a clipboard outside for them to sign, carry their groceries outside to them for that. Most of our kids' cafe sites are already going to be required to have ramps and those kind of systems in place. So make sure that when you're doing your program that you think about that. If I'm coming in a walker or a wheelchair, do I have access to the services that I'm offering? Compliance reviews. Every single person that is a part of these programs will go through some sort of compliance review, whether it's informal or formal. As Second Harvest, we go through compliance reviews quite often from different agencies and institutions. In turn, we are then required to offer and conduct compliance reviews from anyone who receives product from us. So say, for example, even if you say, well, I'm not getting USDA and I'm not going to get GNAP because I don't want to have to go through that review and those kind of audits. Wrong. Because we have that product on site, and at any given moment, you have access to that product to serve just by a signature on an agreement. That makes you under our umbrella requirement to have these compliance reviews. We've had some of our agencies say, well, we never store food here. All we do is give it out in a park. There's no reason to come and look at our stuff. Wrong. Because you have access and the ability to access any of those state funding programs, we then have to prove that we've come and done a visit, We've looked at your existing paperwork. We make sure that poster is in play. We make sure you're not charging for the programs. We make sure you're not discriminating and that your distribution hours, dates, and times are prominently understood and displayed. So yes, because you're a member of Second Harvest, we have to get audited. That means we're required to also provide that same audit and service for you. Now, it's not a scary thing when we come in. If we find something that needs to be adjusted, we say, hey, we need you to adjust this, and then we follow up to make sure it was adjusted. No big deal. We don't want to have to anybody to shut down. We want you to be able to provide services to your community. We want to make that helpful and easy, so don't get nervous when we come and talk about a site visit. I've talked about this already. If there is a complaint that somebody wants to make, I think it's 90 days that I think that it has to, that they have the right to do it. So just because they walk out looking happy, they still have a few months that they may decide, you know what, I am going to complain. So always keep a report or a log if you had an incident somewhere so that you can flip back to it and say, oh yeah, I remember this incident. And then you can have all things together with your information for any questions that you may be asked. So they can do it written or verbal, and it needs to be sent to this person here, and that's on that poster. But they can also go to the USDA.gov website and find it there pretty simply. Now, your civil rights training log. Those of you who are watching this video or using it to train your staff and volunteers, there must be a log that shows the person's name and the date that they received this training, and you have to keep that in your records and accessible at all times. Included with that log of the person's name and date, you need to have some sort of agenda that accompanies that. In other words, what was discussed. The good thing is you can go back and copy these main headings off of this video, and that's your agenda. We discussed these 10 or 12 items in this video, and that's easy to do. So, in conclusion, if you have any questions, you can contact me or my team in Partner Services. I know sometimes the phone system's difficult to navigate, but the 244-2678 is the main number when you're prompted to ask for an extension. 200 or 206 will take you to Partner Services. I know that some people have said, well, the mailboxes are full. Negative. Those two extensions mailboxes are not full because we check them almost daily. And in addition to, we have found that some people have a difficult time listening to all the message before they're prompted to leave a message, and they just assume, well, I don't leave a message here. Listen to all the message, and then you leave us a voicemail, and I promise you we'll get back to you as soon as possible. Thank you for watching this video. Thank you for what you do in partnering with us, and thank you for being a willing servant to our community. Hope you have a great day.